Good morning. You're invited to participate in the morning worship service of First United Methodist Church in downtown Fort Worth, Texas.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ.
Grace and peace to you also.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever.
Let us pray. O God, we join with our sisters and brothers around the world in remembering Christ's sacrifice for us, for the opportunity to eat and drink together, and for the life we have received, we give you thanks and praise. In the abundance of your many gifts, grant us grace to fill one another's lives with love. Redeem, restore, and remold us until we are made new. Transform our daily bread into the bread of life, and the cup that we drink into the cup of salvation. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
A dream. Good morning. I want to welcome you to this service of worship at First United Methodist Church. We are so pleased to have the Centenary College Choir here with us today. That was just fabulous. Thank you so much. What a good representation of a United Methodist school in Louisiana. If this is your first time to worship with us, we are especially glad to have you here today. I would ask that each of you would take the worship registration pad and sign that and send it down the pew. If you would like to join your membership with us today, I would ask you to bring the Today card down front with you at the closing hymn, and we will invite you to come forward at that time. If you'll look in your bulletin, we have a number of things happening here at the church and a number of announcements there. I know it seems like this comes up often, but our directory has now become relatively useless. We have so many new members and so many changes that we are doing a new directory for the church, and this is so important. I know, speaking as a staff person here, you don't know how many times we check that directory to refer to people. So you'll look in there. There's an announcement, Olin Mills directory, and sign up for a time to have your pictures made, you and your family. That is very important, and we would appreciate your doing that. Also, you'll notice several other announcements. Let me just highlight some of those for you. The men's kickoff breakfast is on Saturday the 15th. You can go online and register for that, fill out the survey. The annual day retreat for women is coming up the following Saturday on the 22nd. There are brochures regarding that retreat and all of the programs that are going to be offered on that day. Those are available in the Welcome Center, and you can register in the garden. Notice also that there is a parents' night out coming up this Friday evening. And you have heard in the past couple of weeks, the seminar on the second half of life is happening this coming Saturday. You can register for that online or here at the church office or anytime this week. That is next Saturday, so we do want you to register as soon as possible. There are two Wednesday evening classes that are beginning new that are registering today. Reverend Larry Grubb will be beginning his series on taking the fear out of death. And the following Wednesday evening, the 12th, Dr. Jim Riddlesberger will be reviewing the bestseller God's Politics, which is an excellent book, and you can pick that up in the church office. I do want to remind you that we have dinner on Wednesday evening that's open for anyone, but just make your reservations before noon tomorrow. We also have announcements here about the, the Methodist Information Class. Also information on that, and if you'd like to take a tour of the building, that will be held at right after this service today, and I believe they're meeting up here by the grand piano in the front. Again, we are happy that you are here today, and I do hope that you'll take a few moments to look over those announcements and see the classes and the opportunities that are here to help you serve and also to serve your own needs. Now let our worship continue as we celebrate the sacrament of baptism. I invite Tanya and Patrick Walker to come forward with their son. Beloved of God, baptism is a sign to us of the mercy and grace of God, indicating that we do not come into a relationship with God based on anything that we do or anything that we are, but upon the basis of God's gracious invitation toward us. The baptism of infants is a particularly significant manifestation of this sign of God's grace. And we remember today the words of Jesus when he said, "Let the children come to me, and do not hinder them. For to such as these belongs the kingdom of heaven."
I ask you now, as you stand before God in this congregation, do you affirm your faith in Christ? And do you promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, all nations, and all races? And will you nurture, is it Lane Hudson?
Yes.
Will you nurture Lane Hudson in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? Lane Hudson, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now if you'll place your hands on him. Lane Hudson, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born of water and the Spirit, you will remain a faithful disciple of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Here, let's turn around here. This is Lane Hudson, the newest member of the Household of Faith. And today, we pledge ourselves, along with his parents, to do what we can to help nurture him in the Christian faith so that it's, as he grows up among us, someday he'll stand at this or some other altar and make his own profession of faith in Christ. And all this is God's great gift offered to us without price.
Now let us respond as his family of faith. With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ that Lane Hudson, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed in strength in the way that leads to life eternal.
Ago, the psalmist counseled us to learn to be still so that we might know God. That seems so difficult to do today. There are so many errands to run, children to shuttle, unfinished tasks about the home, things to do for our friends, service commitments to the church, and on the list seems to go. If we're going to be responsible people, when do we have time to be still? It seems to be almost a waste of time to be still. And our tired bodies and our weary schedules remind us that something important is missing. There's an emptiness deep inside. And we ask, what is it, Lord? And the words of the psalmist quietly come again. Be still. Be still. We're here today, God, to be reminded that our most important assignment each day is one that we receive from you. And it doesn't come in the earthquake or the wind or the fire. It comes in a still, small voice. We have a lot of challenges before us in our families, in our church, in our community, and in our global connectedness. The answers seem to elude, even defy solution. Is it possible that the answer is found in getting still, listening, learning, understanding some fresh insights that are right in front of us, and we've not seen or heard them? Or we've seen and heard them in the past and forgotten. We are your disciples, your servants. Instruct us in the stillness of this morning, in the music, in the spoken word, in the sharing of the sacred elements of the bread and the wine this day, as we seek to hear again a fresh word from you, Lord of our life, Master of all creation. We pray in the name of him who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
First reading is from 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 8 through 13. He got up and ate and drank, then he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God. At that place he came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" The word of the Lord.
One, two. I want to add my welcome to the Centenary College Choir. It's always wonderful to have them with us. As many of you know, Susan and I met in the Centenary College Choir, and they are so wonderful. It's always just a little disappointing that they didn't fall apart when we graduated. But I think they're better, in fact, and that's a great thing. We thank you so much for being with us. Will Andrus, the director, has been an important part of my life since I was a teenager. He directed the youth choir at First United Methodist Church of Shreveport, where I was a youth, and had a big part in my call to ministry and in helping me grow in my faith in that experience. And then, of course, was director when Susan and I were in the Centenary Choir. The only problem with Will is he loves to tell stories about stuff I did in the Centenary College Choir. As I told the choir in the first service, let it be a lesson to them that what you do in the choir will follow you all the days of your life. It will never be forgotten. But again, welcome to y'all. And Will, thank you so much for being with us. In these few minutes, I want us to look at the prophet Elijah as we continue our way through Scripture. We meet this prophet today, nicknamed the Stormy Prophet. A good nickname for Elijah because Elijah's life was stormy, it was fiery, it was busy, it was hectic. It was full of activity, often frantic activity. He had great success. He also had great times of discouragement. And today when we meet Elijah, we meet him following all this frantic activity, following times of great challenge, when he had confronted King Ahab and Queen Jezebel about their unfaithfulness to God, how they had built altars to Baal and Asherah, these Canaanite gods, how they had supported the prophets of Baal and Asherah, and they had allowed the prophets of the Lord to be killed. And it was a terrible and dark time in the history of the people of God. Elijah had been the one to confront them, and he had called the people to faithfulness. Choose who you will serve, he said. How long can you go limping on two opinions? If God is God, serve God. If Baal is God, serve Baal. And many of the people turned from following Baal and restored their faithfulness to God. Jezebel then vowed to kill him. She would have him killed if it was the last thing she did. And so Elijah, just before our text for today, is running for his life. It says he got up and fled for his life, and he wound up in the wilderness under a broom tree. And there he wanted simply to curl up and go to sleep. In fact, he really wanted to just curl up under that broom tree and die. He prayed to God, "It is enough. It is enough, O Lord. Go ahead and take my life, for I am no different than my ancestors." In other words, I'm as good as dead anyway. "It is enough, O Lord. Go ahead and take my life." He'd gotten to that place in his life where he just had enough. And he fell asleep. And as he slept, a messenger, an angel of the Lord, it's usually translated, comes, wakes him up, shows him food that's sitting there prepared for him, food and drink. He gets up, he eats the food, and he falls asleep again. Again, the messenger shakes him awake, and he awakens, and he eats that food, and he drinks that drink, and on the strength of that food, journeys 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Horeb, also called Mount Sinai, the mountain of God in the Sinai wilderness. He goes on the strength of that food. This isn't just regular food, you see, but it's food that symbolizes the presence of God to strengthen. And he discovers in the midst of saying, "It is enough, enough is enough, oh God, I've had it," that the food which God offers becomes for him enough. And he says enough with a new tune as he goes in the strength of that food, seeking God at the mountain of God, Mount Horeb. It's a surprise in some ways that we find Elijah in this state of mind. I mean, he's been so successful. I mean, he's had his tremendous downs as well as tremendous ups, but on balance, he's been successful. On balance, God has protected him at all the key points, and then Jezebel threatens his life, and he's had enough, and he flees for his life. He got up and fled for his life. Why did he do that? Well, of course, he's human. Elijah's just human. He had had all he could take. He had had times of frantic activity, nonstop, over and over again, one thing right after another. He had had periods of great difficulty in his life. He had had tremendous successes. He had had huge disappointments. And he was physically and emotionally exhausted. When he arrived at the mountain of God, he was worn out. Well, it says he fled for his life. If we read the Hebrew a little more carefully, some commentators suggest that it could be translated, he got up and went for his soul. I like that translation. He got up and went for his soul. He went for the sake of his soul to the mountain of God. He went to find his soul, went for his soul to the mountain of God. Perhaps he was on, not only fleeing for his life, but he was on a spiritual retreat to experience God. After all the ups and downs, after the frantic activity, after all he had been through, a spiritual retreat. And he went to the right place for that, the mountain of God, the place where God had appeared to Moses, the place where he himself had experienced God before. If you want to find God, why not go to the mountain of God there in the Sinai wilderness, Mount Horeb? And he went there. And when he got there, as Ralph Sockman put it, he was in a cave kind of mood. He just wanted to crawl into a cave. Have you had that experience? Does anything about Elijah's experience ring a bell for you in your own life? Have you been in that place? Frantic activity, ups and downs, difficult times, great successes, huge disappointments, and then following that, exhaustion, relational conflicts in the midst of it all, and just exhausted, worn out, wanting to crawl in a cave someplace and hide. He did that at the mountain of God, seeking God. I can picture him, can't you, in the silence of that cave. Have you ever been on a cave tour where they turn out all the lights? You experienced that? It is dark. They're showing you the darkest that darkness can be. But I've noticed when they turn off the lights, everybody gets completely quiet. And it shows you how silent silence can be. And in the midst of that silence, he is yearning for God. At the mountain of God, the place where one would expect to meet God. Then a wind begins to blow. And it gets stronger and stronger, and it becomes a mighty wind, it says, and it's breaking the rocks in pieces. This wind is so strong. And he is sure that he will experience God in the wind, because everybody knows God inhabits the wind. Wind, breath, spirit, ruach, all the same word in Hebrew. That's where you find God. God inhabits the wind. But God was not in the wind. And I wonder how he felt at that moment. Was he disappointed? Surprised? Surely God's in the wind, but God was not in the wind. And after the wind, a low rumbling begins way underground, and it gets stronger and stronger, and the ground begins to shake, and the rocks start to fall. It's an earthquake. And everybody knows that when God appeared on that mountain to Moses, there was an earthquake. The ground trembled. We all know that. God is in that earthquake. But God was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a roaring, raging fire, when God appeared to Moses in a bush, the bush was on fire. When God appeared on that mountain, there was lots of smoke. Where there's smoke, there's fire. Surely God is in the fire. But God was not in the fire. In all the frantic activity, he was missing an experience with God. When he came to the mountain of God, he looked for God in all the usual places you might expect to find God. But God was not in any of those places. And then after the wind and the earthquake and the fire, there came the sound of a profound silence. It says in our translation. Still small voice, it says in others. The sound of sheer silence. And when Elijah heard it, he knew God was in the silence. And he listened. Someone told me after the first service that the word listen and the word silent have the same letters. I never thought about that. He listened in the silence. And he heard a question that he'd been asking himself, I'm sure. He heard God in that silence speaking a question. What are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here, Elijah? And he began to pray. Oh Lord, the people have fallen away. They've become unfaithful. They've killed the prophets. They have torn down the altars, and I'm the only one left. Do you hear what Elijah's saying? What do we often say when we're in that cave kind of mood? I'm alone in this. No one understands what I'm experiencing. No one knows the cave that I'm in. No one understands. I'm alone in this. I am alone. And he says, I only am left. There are no more faithful ones. And we tend to exaggerate our aloneness and believe we're the only ones in the world. And the voice in the silence continues to speak to him as he listens with his heart. And he learns that he is not alone, that God is with him, and he learns that there are other faithful ones in Israel. And the voice says, not get up and flee for your life, but get up and go back and serve again. Elijah, you're not alone. It is a profound moment for him. Now, what does that have to do with us? We've talked about how we can relate to what was going on with him emotionally, but what about when we're in that cave kind of mood? What do we need more than anything else? Most often, what we need more than anything else is silence. As Larry said in his prayer, silence is very difficult for us to achieve today. A friend and a member of this congregation went on a retreat to Gethsemane Monastery, where they live in silence. It's a retreat that someday I want to experience too, because I find silence to be very difficult. And he found silence to be difficult too. But in the silence, he experienced God in new ways, new insights. We have to have silence in our lives to experience God on that level. And it's so difficult for us. Often our tendency when we're in that cave kind of mood is not to go to silence, but to fill our lives with more frantic activity. And often and with noise as well. Put on the headphones. Pick up the cell phone, turn on the TV, anything we can do to distract us from the silence where we might be alone with ourselves and with God and experience God in that silence. It's a difficult thing for us. And yet, time and again, the great people of faith have stressed the importance of silence. Mother Teresa, in talking about God, said, God is a lover of silence. See how the moon and the stars and the sun move in silence. See how the plants and the trees and the flowers grow in silence. We also may move and grow in silence. Gandhi, when he was battling the tax on salt in India imposed by the British that did not even allow an Indian to pick up a handful of salt found plentifully around the ocean, didn't form a committee or a task force. That's what I would do. I'd form a committee or a task force. We're going to get this solved. He didn't raise an army. He didn't do anything like that. He went away for weeks in silence. And in that silence and in praying and listening, he heard the answer. And he got up and he started walking. And he walked to the sea. And as he walked across the land, people followed. And people all over the world watched as he walked to the sea. And when he got there, he reached down and scooped up a handful of salt. And that was the end of the tax. Where did it come from? Silence. Benedictine monk David Stendhal Rast talks about the power of silence and links it to obedience. The first rule, he says, is listen. And listening requires silence. And he says that obedience at its root comes from the words ab audiens, which means to listen thoroughly. If we are to be obedient, we are to be those who listen thoroughly. Not just do a bunch of things, but listen thoroughly. As we come to the Lord's table today, we come, I'm sure, many of us in a cave kind of mood. We come perhaps physically, emotionally exhausted. We come perhaps out of relational conflict. We come after great success or great disappointment. We come as we are, bringing with us who we are to this table. Some of us come with the words of Elijah, "I've had enough, it's enough." But as we come to this table, we receive a food that's unlike other food. It is the symbol of the body and blood of Christ, the symbol of the presence of Christ, who is food enough for the journey. And we go from this place saying enough with a new tune. It is enough. God is enough. What God provides is enough. The experience of God is enough. Will you take your bulletin? You will find there the invitation, the confession and pardon, and the words of assurance. And let me remind you that all are welcome at the Lord's table. This is the Lord's table. It's not the United Methodist table. Everybody is welcome here. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. This morning, as we look at communion table filled with breads, representing breads from all over the world, as we hear in the prayer the words of Jesus in several languages this morning, we're reminded that Christians all over the world on this World Communion Sunday are celebrating together at the Lord's table. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You made every nation and people on the face of the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. He commissioned us to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth and to make disciples of all nations. And today, his family and all the world is joining at his holy table. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Et après avoir rendu grâce, il le rompit et le donna aux disciples en disant, "Prenez, mangez, ceci est mon corps."
Als sie aber aßen, nahm Jesus das Brot, danke und brach's und gab's den Jüngern und sprach, nehmet, esset, das ist mein Leib.
Y mientras comían, tomó Jesús el pan, y bendijo y lo partió, y dio a sus discípulos, y dijo, tomad, comed, esto es mi cuerpo.
When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Il prit ensuite une coupe, et après avoir rendu grâce, il la leur donna en disant, "Buvez-en tous, car ceci est mon sang, le sang de l'alliance qui est répandu pour plusieurs pour la rémission de péché."
Und nahm den Kelch und dankte, gab ihnen den und sprach, "Trinket alle daraus, das ist mein Blut des Bundes, das vergossen wird für viele zur Vergebung der Sünden."
Y tomando la copa y habiendo dado gracias, les dio diciendo, "Bebed de ella todos, porque esto es mi sangre del nuevo pacto, que por muchos es derramado para remisión de los pecados."
And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and the cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with your church throughout the world and strengthen it in every nation and among every people to witness faithfully in your name. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. When we break the bread, it is a means of sharing in the body of Christ. And when we give thanks over the cup, it is a means of sharing in the blood of Christ. Thank you.
Thank you for joining together with us this morning for Holy Communion as we celebrate World Communion again, sharing communion this morning with Christians around the world, various languages and cultures. We want to thank Pam Cox and Vicki Metcalf also for the special presentation of breads this morning that, again, represents symbolically our participation with other Christians around the world in a sense of unity in Christ today. Would you please turn to your bulletins and join together with our unison prayer, our prayer after communion. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we stand to sing hymn number 623, we invite you into membership and fellowship with us today.
Delighted to introduce to you the newest members of our congregation. Here on my right is Kenneth Caston. His bride is already a member of our church, and we welcome Kenneth into the First Methodist family. And on my left is Amanda Gann and John Churchill, coming from another United Methodist church, and they are engaged to be married.
Did you have others from earlier?
At the early service, we had Marcia Sickman, Johanna Hamilton, and Mariah Williams join our church.
Well, I ask you all, as you become a part of this congregation, do you reaffirm your faith in Christ? And will you be loyal to the church and uphold it by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? Welcome.
Thank you.
Glad you're up here. I'm going to ask all of them to remain down front to give you a chance to come by and give them a warm First Church welcome as the newest members of this community of faith. Our gathering will soon be ended. Where will we go and what will we do? May grace, peace, hope, love, and joy forever accompany you. Amen.